Hey, I got a question for you. Anyone ever seen that picture? What? What is it? Amen, sister. I'm glad you're here today. So, Boston is my favorite band of all time. I have a lot of memories with this group. Classic rock band. They came out with their debut album in 1976. And you probably recognize this song. Listen very carefully. It's okay. Where I know I'm playing secular music in church. There are no bad words. Here we go. Anyone ever heard that? And if you know the drums, right? Famous, right? I'm just going to play about a minute of it because the chorus might jog your memory. Right? And then here goes the famous chorus. Everybody know, I know you're thinking, why is he playing rock and roll in church? You'll get it. True with Christ. All right, so now you got it, right? Well, then they came out with a second album 2 years later, and the title of that album is called Don't Look Back, and that album cover looks like that, right? And this song is probably the one you might know off this album. And in Christ, obviously, we don't look back, do we? Right? Has everybody heard it? Some of you, maybe? I thought about singing it up here to see if you would remember it, but I can't sing that high. All right. So here are some words from the lead singer, Brad Delp, and Tom Scholz, who was the driving force behind the band. Now you're climbing to the top of the company ladder. Hope it doesn't take too long. Can't you see there'll come a day when it won't matter? Come a day when you'll be gone. I understand about indecision, but I don't care if I get behind people living in competition. All I want is to have my peace of mind, right? Sounds very positive. 76. And then the chorus there. Don't look back. A new day is breaking. It's been too long since I felt this way. I don't mind where I get taken. The road is calling. Today is the day. I can see it took so long just to realize. I'm much too strong not to compromise. Now I see. What I am is holding me down. I'll turn it around. Oh, yes, I will. Sounds positive, right? A lot of positive vibes, willpower, and it changed my life, new direction, right? Well, there's the lead singer, Brad Delp, one of the greatest voices in rock and roll of all time. Brad Delp. He was the lead vocalist. This is on KLOS, Southern California rock station, of the famous American rock band, Boston. With all of the fame and success of the band throughout the decades, it seemed Delp had it all. However, behind the scenes, that was not the case. March 9, 2007, Delp's fiancée, Pamela Sullivan, found him dead at his home in Atkinson, New Hampshire. His death was deemed a suicide by carbon monoxide poisoning. A suicide letter was found that referenced a character's note in the series Twin Peaks that read by his own hand, Mr. Brad Delp, J'ai un nom solitaire, I am a lonely soul. He was 55, KLOS Radio. Shocking. It's shocking. Because you listen to some of the lyrics and you listen to the music and they trigger so many wonderful memories for me. You know, my best friend Don, high school, we'd go skiing and we'd listen to Boston all the way up to Sierra at Tahoe. Back then it was called Sierra Ski Ranch. Maybe some of you remember. Tremendous memories. We talked about Twin Peaks. The title of the next two messages is Two Towers. Two Towers. Babylon. Babylon. Get it? It's supposed to be funny. Or Beulah. Babylon or Beulah? Which towers? We read a portion of this passage in Psalm 49. And it's a really sobering passage. But as is the manner of God's mercy and grace, on the one hand, there are lots of sobering passages in Scripture. But on the other, there's joy. And there's a well-known saying that comes from the Bible. Sorrow endures for a moment, but what? Joy comes in the morning. And there was sorrow under that old covenant, but we now have the joy of the newness of life in Christ. Now, the truth is, and I am asked this question so often, I don't know what Brad Delp believed, but I'm, as a minister, you know, you get asked these questions because people kind of assume, oh, they've got all the answers. But I get asked the question, you know, when someone takes their life, a believer in Christ, when they take their life, are they a Christian? And I sit there and I think to myself, did Jesus only die for some sins? Right? So no sin goes uncovered by the blood of Jesus. Amen? No sin. And when you grow up in a legalistic, ritualistic environment, sometimes you are categorizing sins in a way that the Bible does not. And it does bring out of us some sort of judgment, a spirit of self-righteousness where we look at others with contempt. We might look at a Christian who commits suicide. Oh, I can't believe he or she did that. Or maybe a Christian goes to jail, DUI, maybe kills a family. Who knows? Christians are not immune. They're not immune from any area of disobedience. Now, some carry steeper implications, you know, but it doesn't mean that that person is worse. There's no such thing in the theology of Jesus. Jesus does not look at people and say, well, these ones are worse. You remember, we've talked about it before. The Pharisees thought that that tower that fell on those people, that was the result of them being worse sinners. Remember, Jesus says, you think that they were sinners above anyone else? He turned to the Pharisees and said, except you repent, you likewise shall perish, right? And they were very, very self-righteous, and they did perish. That's what Jesus taught. And we see this by Josephus, who was a Jewish historian. And he documented God's wrath against those self-righteous Pharisees by the hand of the Romans. And Jesus predicted it. We see that. But in this passage, which is so beautiful, we do see sobriety, but we also see great joy as we prepare for communion. Psalm 49, verses 4 through 20. I will incline my ear to a proverb. I will solve my riddle to the music of the harp. Why should I fear in times of trouble? When the iniquity of my persecutors surrounds me. And it's very likely that this is a messianic psalm. Those who trust in their wealth and boast of the abundance of their riches. Again, it is not a sin to be rich. But it says, if riches increase, the word of God says, do not set your heart upon them. If riches increase. Now that I don't speak from experience. I hope one day I could. But no, I always tell people the reason I'm not rich is because God knows I probably wouldn't be able to handle it. Remember? I'd buy that crazy car and kill myself. But we tend to think of the wealthy in 21st century categories. Bill Gates, Warren Buffett. But if you were in the time of the first century, the wealthy were the Torah followers. The wealthy were the self-righteous. You were in their club. If you weren't a sinner, you were in their club. And you climbed to the top of the company ladder, right? Jesus spoke about climbing up some other way. And they would reserve for themselves the best seats in the synagogues. And James writes to these Pharisees. And he says, that's what you do. And he says, you're partial. You're respecters of persons. You know, the Bible says God is no respecter of persons. Amen. I'm so glad because I would never get in. I'd never make it. But we can use this today as we think about how important riches are to so many people today. I just got a tragic text by a girl who, you know, she was kind of sweet on my younger son, and nothing ever worked out. She's out in Colorado. And, you know, she knows that I'm a minister, and every once in a while she'll, you know, ask me some questions. She's searching. And she wrote me this text. You can't make this up. I literally got that text this morning. And that she says, my greatest goal in life is to just make a lot of money and have my own business. And, you know, I think she's maybe 19 or 20. And it just crushed my heart as I, you know, prepared this message. It was just so weird that I would get such a text this morning. That's bizarre. It's just bizarre, but God knows what he's doing. And I said, you know, I've got some things I'd like to share, because she's asking me a question. And then she sends this one text. You know, some people speak of God in generic terms, right? God. They're not necessarily referring to Jesus, our Lord, but they speak of God in generic terms. She goes, well, maybe I should figure out what God wants for me, right? Because I think she was raised in an agnostic environment. Amen. Truly, no ransom. Now, here's the sobering part in the Old Testament. No ransom avails for one's life. There is no price one can give to God for it. For our soul. For the ransom of life is costly and can never suffice. In other words, what he's saying is there is no amount any of us could ever pay to buy back our soul. That one should live on forever and never see the grave. I don't know about you, but the first thing that comes to my mind when I see that is the resurrection. When we look at the wise, they die. Fool and dolt perish together and leave their wealth to others. One of the saddest stories was just to watch Steve Jobs, so wealthy, so brilliant, genius, and just to die of cancer, to wither away. There was nothing. All his billions couldn't save his life. Their graves are their homes forever. And again, I'm not making a statement about Steve Jobs or his, I don't know anything about what he believed, okay? So please understand that. As I make a reference to people, that's not me making a statement about their soul or their destiny. I think that that's foolish when we do that. We shouldn't do that. their dwelling places to all generations, though they named lands their own. You know, we see that. Even some pews. Have you ever seen that in churches? Right? Someone buys a pew. Right? Put my name on there. Hey, nothing wrong with it. I'm just saying. Right? We have to be careful. Stained glass windows are beautiful. You know, but maybe sometimes, I'm not saying this is all the time the case, but maybe sometimes we have our names put on things. Maybe street signs or, you know, a building, you know, might say the Trump Tower, right? Or, like I said, maybe on a stained glass window. But how important will those people think those plaques are in the end? Mortals cannot abide in their pomp. It's all of us. They're like the animals that perish. Such is the fate of the foolhardy, the end of those who are pleased with what? Their lot. They're satisfied with their land, their property, their money, their works, their self-righteousness, their religiosity. Remember, we just read it. The Lord is our portion. The Lord is our lot. That's what God said to Abraham. Remember, I am your exceeding and great reward. Me. Whom have I in heaven but thee? Remember that? You're all I desire, the psalmist said. But it's so tempting to be troubled when we see the wicked prosper. But the reality is we all were wicked, as Paul said in Romans chapter 3. And we should thank God. Paul said this. He wasn't a rich guy. He said, I have learned to be content in whatever state I am. Does anyone know what state Paul was in the first century? Well, he was a tent maker. And I think he was beaten two or three times with 39 lashes. And he had rocks thrown at him until they thought he was dead, right? So, you know, I you just have to visualize these things. He was robbed by bandits as he was going to tell people about Jesus. But he said, I count all of my infirmities, all of these tribulations that I'm enduring for Jesus. He said, I count all of them as joy. He was joyful in the midst of all that. He didn't have money. The prosperity gospel is so foolish because it teaches us that if we don't have money, it's because we don't have enough faith. That's televangelism. Stay away from it. It is so unhealthy. It will crush you because they say that if you're sick, you don't have enough faith. It's tragic. We've seen so many people who love the joy of Jesus going through some of the worst sicknesses to the very end. That's what I saw, honestly, Ed, in Long. I saw joy in him the last time that I saw him alive. And there he was literally, he was on his deathbed. I think he died the next day. Like sheep, they are appointed to Sheol. Yeah, so whenever you have an evil... No, Sheol, it's just a word that means grave. That's what it means. And some translations do say grave. I believe this is the New Revised Standard. So Sheol, it's just the grave. And it says, God will, watch this. Death shall be their shepherd. Straight to the grave they descend. Those that trust in their self-righteousness, trust in their riches. And their form shall waste away. The grave shall be their home. But God will what? Ransom my soul from the power of the grave, for he will receive me. And it's so wonderful because Ephesians says he has received us Emmanuel, with us is God. He has accepted us into his presence. What a privilege, amen? Do not be afraid when some become rich. I'll tell you right now, one of the first things I do in the morning is I just look at the superficial titles of articles. And like I told my mom and Austin, I just make sure that a nuclear bomb hasn't been dropped, and then I move on. I very rarely actually go into detail for any of these articles, but every once in a while, I want to find out what Elon Musk is doing because I really like the Cybertruck. But I see so much stuff flash in front of my brain, plural, flash in front of my brain, these people who make money so quickly off these YouTube videos and these TikTok videos and these various Twitter things that you just are making money like crazy, and they're encouraging you how to do it. And then you see these people dying at 20, 24, 27. They're so young and they're so unhappy, but they seemed happy in all those videos, right? Dancing, laughing, traveling, you know, it's hard to imagine, but they're going to all these different places all over the world and filming themselves and making money off people watching their videos. Again, there's nothing wrong with that. But where's our heart? Do not be afraid when some become rich, when the wealth of their houses increases. For when they die, you've heard this, you can't take it with you, right? You've heard the famous, do you ever see a hearse, you know? What is it? How's that saying go? Pull on a trailer? Right? You never see it. I saw one hearse. I mean, seriously, this is some wealthy person had this hearse, and it was a Porsche. Yeah, I kid you not. I saw another one. It was a Rolls Royce hearse. Wow. I mean, I'd drive it. But no, I think my hearse is going to be a Prius V. For when they die, they will carry nothing away. Their wealth will not go down after them, though in their lifetime they count themselves happy. For you are praised when you do well for yourself. They will go to the company of their ancestors, Sheol, the grave, who will never again see the light. Mortals cannot abide in their pomp. They are like the animals that perish. So discouraging, isn't it? So I think what God does in the Old Testament, in some of these passages that seem so discouraging, so morose, is that he throws in this glimmer of hope for which all of these Old Testament believers, these Old Testament prophets, great women and men of the faith, they were longing for this time when God, Emmanuel, would set his tabernacle among us, where he said, I will be their God, and they will be my people, and I will dwell among them, and I will walk among them. And that has been fulfilled in Jesus Christ. He is with us. God with us. The great Christmas and Easter story. So as we prepare for communion, God will ransom, it's in the passage, Psalm 49. God will ransom my soul from the power of the grave. And we ask, did he fulfill this? And we answer with a resounding yes. Jesus said, for the Son of Man, Mark 10:45, for the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and what? Let's read it together. And to give his life a ransom for many. Can I get a hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
Isn't that beautiful? He has ransomed us. He paid the amount that we could not pay. Our soul was too costly. Our soul was costly, and Jesus said, I want you so badly. I want you to be with me so badly that I will come and do it for you. And I've never sinned. I'm perfectly holy, the spotless Lamb of God. And I desire to be with you so much God so loved the world, right? That he paid the ransom. It's done. He's ransomed our soul from the power of the grave. And he said, the one who lives and believes in me will never die. And again, that's the question he asked to Martha. Do you believe this? Amen? So it's beautiful to read these Psalms with a covenantal understanding. In those places where it seems so down and so dreary and so dark and dismal, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, and that light is Jesus, and we have him through his sacrifice.